Hi, everybody. I'm Sophie Bennett. I'm a consultant supporting the Science and Technology Directorate and FEMA IPAWS. Today, I'm going to talk to you about the importance of efficient tools to support you in being able to send emergency alerts comprehensively. So I know this is IPAWS focused, but the toolkit actually covers a whole list of tools and techniques that we've gathered from research over the last couple of years. So the purpose of the IPAWS toolkit is to assist public safety agencies in minimizing alerting delays, help y'all to plan for future enhancements. So I know there are things coming down the pipeline with being able to alert in closer quarters and being able to facilitate across different technologies, and then also improving information sharing with the public. So I will slide right over to the toolkit. This is live on FEMA.gov, and I will post the link in the chat when I'm done, but I won't do it just yet so we don't flood the server. So this is on FEMA.gov. If you scroll down, you've got the option here. This is the link to the toolkit, or you can download the blank template. We also have some additional information on signing up for IPAWS. The IPAWS process playbook is a really useful resource, and then some info on how to find an alerting vendor, which is also all along this sideboard bar here. So I'll click into the toolkit. We'll give it a second. There's 5 different steps here. So we start with system information. We go into standard operating procedures, the messaging templates that Dr. Sutton mentioned, some training and test information, exercises, and then you do have the option here to review and download at the end. So all of this, you might notice it slightly reflects the SAFECOM interoperability continuum, but it's tailored for emergency alerts and warnings. So all of the following prompts in step 1 is all going to be about which systems are you using. I will note here, so we've estimated based on the pilots that we did that it'll take about 2 hours if you sit down and do it in one big chunk and you have all the information you need. But we've heard from our pilots that it can take up to 8 like full days, depending on your familiarity. And then once you're started, so this was something that was really, really important, is that nothing saves. So FEMA doesn't get any of this information. This is cookies based, so it's stored in your browser and it'll stay for 14 days. So if you're worried about your browser clearing your cache, I would highly recommend just like rapid clicking through, downloading that document once you're done and making sure that your information is saved, just in case. So I will fill this out. So you had to go. So we start off right off the bat. Who are you and why are you filling this out? So we'll just say that I'm Office of Emergency Services. We're going to prepare it today. And then we ask some basic questions. So why are you hoping to have a plan for alerts, warnings, and notifications? And actually, Justin, could we do the poll right now? I feel like this is a good spot to just ask if people have a plan before we get into this.
Sure. This is Justin opening it now. Okay. I think I'm about to hit the button.
All right, let's do it.
There we go.
Wanted to ask this question because I've heard from some of the people we've talked with that not having the toolkit, they had some issues creating plans just from scratch. I had one guy tell me, and it broke my heart, that he spent 6 weeks Googling, finding other people's plans, gathering all the information, not even making his plan, just coming up with a template. So I'm very curious what other people feel are some of their challenges getting this plan started, and then we can get into why this will help.
I think your top answer, which we'll see here in a few seconds, is sympathizing with the man you just spoke of.
Yeah.
So in 20 seconds, running out of time.
Get your answers in.
And Sophie, I want you to make sure that you can see these answers too. I know I'm sharing them with everybody, but I'll make sure the presenters can see them as well.
Great.
Can you see it?
Yep. So it does look like, what is C? C has 48%. So that's great. Good to know, everybody. Thank you for answering. Okay, so right here, right off the bat, why are you filling out your plan? How is this going to help your day-to-day operations? And then we ask you, what are the systems and tactics that you're currently using? I had gone through here and clicked all of them, but we don't need to do that for this demonstration. So everything from sensors to your weather radio to social media, we've heard you use it all. And so they're listed here as options. So for this, obviously, where it will do IPAWS, WIA, and then let's just say you're using social media as your other means of getting information out to the public. So the next page is going to be talking about each individual system. Who is the audience? So if you're using WIA, obviously you're using your residents with cell phones in the affected area. And the benefits will be that you can reach the public that hasn't opted in. So that would be your vendor system. So we're wanting to reach people that maybe they're traveling through. And so this would be just WIA based, and you can type in, who are you contacting? Maybe it's, you're putting Jody's information here or your vendor's information, but it's all in one place so that if you're not there that day and you're the only person who knows how to send the alerts, there's a backup plan, there's a system in place. So there's the same thing for social media. And if you clicked on any others, the same boxes will pull up. We don't have contact information and login instructions for everything, just the ones that are required. So then this is the largest section, the standard operating procedures. This is super helpful in making sure that the alerting process is quick, accurate, and avoids public confusion. Everything that Dr. Sutton talked about in her session with the social science behind how people react. This is all preparing for the whatever is going to happen. So we ask a little bit about training guidelines right off the bat. Who is filling out this form? Are you the actual alert originator pressing the button and you're also making the plan? Are you the alerting authority as well? Occur in your positions? Are you getting that alert originator into the monthly test lab once a month? And then maybe the alerting authority, the higher authority who only has to help everybody, maybe they're only yearly training. And then we've got some suggestions here. So you're not having to, again, search for what the recommendations are. We've got them right here. So like I said, the monthly tests are required. You've got the IS-247, IS-251, and then similar for alerting authority training suggestions and requirements. So you know it's going to be in your plan for anybody else that comes in. We then ask some credential management guidelines. So something that I heard is an issue is that your accounts sometimes need to be updated or logged into a certain amount of time. So if you know that that password is going to expire or that account is going to expire, if it's not logged into continuously, you can put that information in there. So I think my Google password expires every 6 weeks, which is the example I used. And then obviously you don't want to put your username and password into a plan, because if it gets into the wrong hands, they've got access to your system. But we have storage guidelines. So just like some hints and tricks to help you figure out, oh, right, the username was my email address and the year my kid was born, like whatever it is that's going to get you prompted to remember in an emergency. And the same thing with character requirements. A lot of times those passwords are going to require some wonky characteristics. And this is just going to help you remember. So then This one will help you with your training schedule. So if you've got other roles in your organization outside of alert originator and alerting authority, you've got the ability here to add as many as you have. So it'll create a structure for you. Like I said, this is the longest section. So I think there's 3 or 4 pages, and I won't talk about each one, but we'll scroll through the sections. So 2.4 is risk mitigation. So you're not going to be writing it and then immediately sending it, I'm assuming. There's probably going to be an approval chain of command. And so this also will create a structure for you where you can add as many as you need or remove them if it's not required. So I remember one of the speakers earlier talked about cross-jurisdictional alerting. So here we do have a section on agreements with other alerting authorities. So if you have yes, it's just a recommendation to consider attaching the MOA or the Memorandum of Agreement or Understanding into the plan once you download it. Coming soon in the September release, if you click no, it'll actually prompt you on all of the sections and steps to create your own MOA. So just saving you a step if you don't have a template pre-made. And same with I don't know. So here you can list your policy for the chain of command. So if you know you need to send an alert and it's across your border, who is the contact information, who all needs to approve that, that would go there. Here's also a section on knowledge redundancy. So I mentioned this earlier, if you're sick or you're out, who is going to be able to follow up and be able to help you out if you're not there? What is the policy on backing up data? So making sure you're not going to lose this plan or anything else you have saved. What happens if you need to cancel a message? What happens if a false alert goes out? So these are all things that we've seen happen, and I've heard directly from y'all that it was stressful and awful. And so just to get this out of the way early, it has you thinking about every scenario that could come up in an emergency before that happens. So then there's some more file storage. So just in case, like if your pre-scripted messages are somewhere else, easy to find them, your training materials, your message translation plans. So if you have a religious organization or a community organization that helps with your translations, what is your plan for mitigating errors if somebody says you spelled something wrong or that word does not mean what you think it means? That just helps you to plan ahead. So then event codes are also part of standard operating procedures. We've got them all listed. You can find them in the event code glossary, all of the definitions. And then in your agreement with IPAWS, it shows you which codes you're authorized to use. So this is just an exercise to remind you. And it'll actually do so. If you have your administrative message and it only goes out to WIA, what are those parameters? And then if you've got civil danger, it only goes EAS, for example. Why are you sending that message? What are those parameters there? There we go. So then this is the last page in SOPs, just provide some information from your vendor. If they gave you instructions, that's a good place to attach them in the final plan. Oh, one more page for testing, sorry. Like I said, the longest section. So this is just your schedule. What day of the week are you doing that required monthly test through the TSSF? How are you accessing it? And that's actually, I have to make that note. It used to be the IPAWS lab and they've changed their name and we need to update that in the plan. All right, so we're almost through. And of course your audit schedule. So how often are you gonna come back and check this plan? Super important to know in advance. So I won't spend too much time in messaging templates because Dr. Sutton did an amazing job talking about the importance, but we've got a tool in here that can help while you're waiting on her templates. So it walks you through everything she talked about. We followed her social science research and Dr. Dennis Maletti's social science research, and we actually have a counter in here too. So of emergency services, take shelter. in this area until 4 p.m. We can generate the 90 character message, and it shows you we used 40 characters, so you've got 26 out of 90 left. And this will let you, if we wanted to go back through and make another, they just gather at the bottom, and it makes it really, really easy to do a bunch of different scenarios. And then they'll show up in the downloaded version as well. And we've got the same thing for the 360 character message template. So we'll save and continue. I want to make sure we've got time to show the download, because it does show up as a Word document, which is really nice. So then training and system test information. This is mostly guidance. There isn't a ton to fill out in these next two sections, but just asking if you've got any additional training, and then the recommended hands-on use training for your different positions. Same with exercises, so just some recommendations following the Homeland Security Exercise Evaluation Program, different scenarios, exercise injects, and then how to include exercises while using IPAWS. And I know it was mentioned with Jen Meyer, they're doing it in the lab, and you can fill it out in your plan as well, so you have it in several different places. All right. So this is the final step, review and download. Basically, if you don't want to look over anything and you're just like, I want to edit my document, give it to me. You've got it right at the top. You can download it here, or you've got the option to scroll through everything you filled out, make sure it looks okay, and then you can download at the bottom, which is what I will do. Shows up as a Word document. We'll click on that link. Give it a second. All right. So here we go. Like I said, it shows up as a Word document. We've got some guidance on how to insert a table of contents if you want to be able to easily access different sections of your plan. And then it has everything we just talked about. So here's your organization, the date prepared. We're back up at the top, and it has all of the questions. So if you need to edit later on, it does have everything you need.